people and fellows of the Royal Society and noblemen and aristocrats and the professions that he described. Shall we wait for the aeroplane to pass?
Yeah. A windy air path.
Yeah. I'd like to get you back to as far as the AIDS being a start.
Yeah.
AIDS being infected.
Yeah. Yeah.
But this sort of ties in, doesn't it? Because
yeah.
This is where you're saying that AIDS...
That's why I'm saying AIDS is... saying AIDS was, in my opinion, and based obviously on this 8 years of research, is that their objective in developing the HIV virus and unleashing it was genocide. And genocide in the sense of Nazi-style genocide, where they wanted to kill the blacks in Africa, they wanted to kill blacks and or dark-skinned people in South America and Asia and the Pacific Islands. And the only people who would want to do that would be very racist white people. And where would these very racist white people be? Well, my evidence suggests that those very racist white people are in America. And some are in Australia. And some are in England. And they are selecting. The reason that I became interested in AIDS, as I said, is that I noticed that the same targets of Nazi eugenic programs were being targeted by AIDS, the high-risk groups, what they were calling, which was primarily homosexuals, intravenous drug users, prostitutes, and blacks. Or basically, the Germans genocided non-Germans, but they had the concept of Aryan supremacy. And even though they targeted Jewish people, the initial people, Francis Galton and crowd, who developed the eugenics doctrine, did not include Jewish people as being degenerate. They said, in fact, that the Jewish people were very intelligent.
Right.
So what I'm saying is that the same racist theories were exported to Germany, and I've got a lot of evidence to prove this, in fact, that when Galton came up with his theory that the white race was intellectually superior to African races, who were in turn intellectually superior to the Australian Aboriginal, even though he never came to Australia or ever met an Aboriginal person, mind you, that his theory was very warmly embraced by all the Australian institutions, the university system, because he came from Cambridge. And basically what was said in Cambridge was accepted as gospel by the Australian universities, University of Melbourne in particular, which is associated with Cambridge.
Yeah.
But also University of New South Wales, Sydney, University of Queensland, University of Western Australia, University of South Australia, all the major cities. But also the eugenics ideas were also warmly embraced by Harvard University and the American universities. Because if you think back to even the 1950s, they had a color bar in all these places. Right. There was a color bar in the southern states of America.
Yeah.
In Australia, there was a white Australia policy.
Yeah.
Of course, they were very... And if you then look at... and you can go to the University of Melbourne, to the library and the archives, and you'll find a whole bunch of books that the University of Melbourne actually bought, which were explaining the need for eugenic reforms. And that eugenics basically is the way of the future. They wanted it to become the religion of the future.
Yeah.
So it's all about basically killing off blacks and encouraging not all whites, but superior whites in their estimate of who was superior, which meant, of course, the professional classes.
The useful, as deemed in their eyes.
Well, the point is, yes, the useful, in a sense, they were not so naive as to believe that the slaves were not necessary.
Right.
But they wanted to have more of their own kin and people who were going to protect their empire. But they needed to have, one of the things that Galton himself said is that blacks and not whites have got a slavish instinct, which means that they are naturally suited to become slaves.
In his opinion, as a white racist.
Exactly. And it would be easy to dismiss Galton as a narrow-minded white racist, wait not for the fact that he became the father of experimental psychology. He developed IQ tests, he developed culture tests, he developed personality tests, he developed the whole bell curve phenomenon. He was basically, he started studying mathematics and he also started studying medicine, and then he got a big inheritance at the age of 23 and abandoned his medical studies. And basically got, his father was groomed him to walk the corridors of power. So, you know, Charles Darwin being, of course, a very powerful man at that stage, Galton absolutely